This is The Secret Library, a podcast about writing and publishing books. I'm Caroline Donahue, a life coach who works with writers, and I'm here to tell you this is your year. It's time to stop waiting and start writing. This week, The Secret Library podcast is sponsored by Audible. To get a 30-day trial complete with a free audiobook download, visit secretlibrarypodcast.com/audible. This is episode 99. My guest this week is Emma Longworth, who has written for The Washington Post, The London Times, The Independent, and Bon Appetit magazine. She's the author of a mystery series set in southern France, Verlaque and Bonnet, Provençal Mysteries, published by Penguin. Death at the Chateau Bremont was published in June 2011, and the series has followed since. The most recent installment is The Secrets of the Bastide Blanche. She has lived full-time in France for over 19 years and divides her time between Aix-en-Provence, where she writes, and Paris, where she teaches writing at New York University's Paris campus. I was so excited to speak to ML Longworth because I have long really enjoyed her mystery series because of how beautifully it captures the atmosphere, the food, and the charm of southern France. And I was particularly excited to speak to her about her story of how she and her husband on a lark did a search while on vacation in France to see if maybe they might be able to move there. And then the rest is history. So she was very generous in sharing the story of how she moved to France, how her writing life began there, and how she's been successfully publishing books and teaching writing ever since. If you've ever dreamed of being an expat and writing from another place in the world, I know this episode will be incredibly inspiring. So let's get started with ML Longworth. Hey, ML, thanks so much for coming on the show.
Thank you. Thanks for the invite.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I have. I was excited to talk to you because I have been reading this series up to this point. So I was like, "Oh, how exciting!" Because as a Francophile, I can't resist any story that takes place in France. And maybe we should start with France because you are a Canadian writer who's ended up in Aix, and I'm. You know, and you've done it. You know, there's a lot of people sort of moving abroad these days, but you did it quite some time ago. So I'm interested in how you started in Canada and ended up in France.
Okay. Yeah. It was 20 years ago that we arrived in France, but before that we were in California for almost 10 years, for about 9 years. And we were in Santa Cruz, just south of San Francisco on the Monterey Bay. And I was doing graduate work in art history. My husband had a job taking care of a website for a small Silicon Valley startup. And our daughter was just turning four. She was 3.5. And the startup was sold. And so we had a chance either to find another job or move to Oregon, where the company was going to be relocated, or do something kind of crazy. And we were on our way to France. Yeah. And we loved California. We loved Santa Cruz especially. But we'd always talked about wanting our daughter to be bilingual. And we had planned a 2-week trip to France, you know, kind of a typical 1 week in Paris, 1 week in Provence. I had never been to Provence, but my husband had. And he spoke French. His mother was a French professor growing up at a university near Toronto. So he and his sisters were raised speaking French. So we wanted the same thing for our daughter. So it was just before we were about to fly to Paris, and I was in his office playing on his computer, and it was the internet was brand new. And I said, "How does this internet thing work?" It was before, and it was before Google. So he said, "Well, whatever you're looking for, just tap in some keywords. 3 keywords is usually good." And so I tapped in France computers jobs, and I found a job in France for a webmaster, which is what my husband was doing. And it was 1996 then, November 1996, and they wanted somebody bilingual, French-English, with Silicon Valley experience.
Perfect.
It was perfect. And so I read out the job description to my husband. He said, "That sounds like me." And I said, "I know." And I said, "Well, why don't you try to get an interview?" And we looked at the name of where the company was. We'd never heard of the company. It was a French company, and it was located in a place called Geminos. And he said, don't get too excited about that. It's probably an awful suburb of Paris, you know, in an industrial zone. And so I ran across the street to the bookshop Santa Cruz, and bought a Michelin map and brought it back to his office. And we looked up the location of Geminos, and it looked like it was about a 15-minute drive from the Mediterranean down in Provence. And so he immediately
called. That's a little better.
Yeah, it's a little better than an industrial suburb. Yeah. And so he called the company up and explained, I'm going to be in Provence in 2 weeks on vacation. And they said, can you come for an interview? You know, after he had sent them his resume. And so we went for the interview. He said, I was in a little cafe. It was a beautiful weather. And so I was sitting outside, and he told the waiter, take care of my wife and my daughter. They don't speak French. And the waiter was very obliging, refilling my cup, my glass with a rosé. And our daughter just went off and started playing with the kids, you know, in the village square, or, you know, right in front of the cafe. And it was very, very, very picturesque. And my husband came back 2 hours later, and he said, the interview went really well. I'm really worried now. And yeah, because, you know, you dream about something, and then when it's actually handed to you, then you see, oh my gosh, you know, we weren't serious about this. What do we do? And a few days later, we were at our hotel in Toulouse, in the Southwest, and the company called and they said, we'd like to offer you the job, and we'll give you 2 weeks to think about it, to decide. So we flew home to California.
That's very civilized.
Yes, yeah. And we thought about it, and all of our friends said, go, you know, go. And so we did. And we thought we'd stay for 2 years. And we found a house in Aix-en-Provence. We kind of decided that's where we wanted to be, which was only about a 25-minute drive to Geminos, this little village. And we thought, well, we'll give it 2 years. And so we've been here 20 years. And our daughter's now 24 and she lives and works in Paris. And we're very, very happy here. So voila.
That's amazing. Yeah. I am amazed that you didn't speak French going into this, because your series of books is so... I think one of the things that many people say, and I loved about it too, is it's like, I mean, obviously you have lots of experience being there, but it feels like a native talking about their home.
Yeah, I hope so too. And I think the thing is, we live here full time, and we immediately put our daughter into a French school, public school, and even though there's a pretty big expat community in Aix, we didn't join any expat groups. And we lived downtown in an apartment building. And when you live downtown in an apartment building, you really do have to, you know, make friends quickly, be friends with your neighbors, because everyone lives in close proximity. And all our neighbors were French. And so Eva, our daughter, immediately, you know, met friends. So we became friends of the parents, you know, and I think it helps to have a child in the public school system whenever you move to a new place. And we were on the third floor of an apartment, and the woman who was on the first floor, she is a math teacher in a local high school, and she had three children. One of them was Eva's age, and she and I became best friends. And she was recently divorced. She needed a friend. You know, I needed a friend because, you know, I didn't speak French yet. You know, we were new to the city. And that really, really helped. And through her, you know, we met other people, and we became, you know, a very close group of friends, about, you know, 12 or 14 of us. So, yeah, I do very much feel like a local.
Amazing. So, and then you just learned French as an adult because you were thrown into the deep end.
That's right. I mean, growing up near Toronto, we did do, you know, a fair number of French classes in junior high, not even in junior high, mostly high school, but it was, you know, very, very basic. And so I had to start over at, you know, age 35.
Amazing.
But, you know, having friends, you know, helps, because you want to make yourself understood, and you want to understand what's being said at a dinner party, or when you're shopping, or whenever. So
yeah, it's a whole different level when you get into that. So. No. So then how did you begin to write the series, and how did the series come out of this experience of living there?
Yeah. Well, as soon as we moved here, I mean, my husband was busy with his new job, and then, Eva then, you know, when she was five, started school, and I found myself at home without working papers, because it takes quite a while to get them in France. And so I thought, well, I'll start writing about France. I'll start writing about X. And I had taken a class in Santa Cruz about sort of one of those weekend classes, you know, release the writer within you, one of those kinds of classes. And my husband said, you know, the things that you did for that class, you know, I enjoyed reading them. And when you write letters back home, everyone says, oh, you know, your letters are really fun to read. He said, why don't you try writing about X and sending off to a newspaper? So because I had done work in art history, I wrote about Cézanne, because Paul Cézanne is from X. And mm-hmm. I wrote about a travel, what I thought was a travel article for you know, a newspaper about Cézanne's ex. And I sent it to the New York Times, very pleased with myself that it was, you know, I finished it and I thought it was well written and well researched. And I got a postcard back from the New York Times. No, thank you. You know, sort of. So I filed that. I filed that away. And my husband said, why don't you try for a really small newspaper? You know, the Santa Cruz Sentinel or, so I didn't listen to his advice and I sent it to the Washington Post, and the travel editor at the Times wrote me back. I remember his name was Craig, and I still have his email because it was so nice. It was, he said, you're almost there. He says, I really like the article, but you're still writing a little bit like an art historian and you're missing the senses. And this is something that I talk about with my students at NYU. He goes, go back into X, go back into the hills where Cézanne walked. What did he smell? What did he taste? What did he hear? And those were the things that I, you know, as a novice, I was kind of missing. So I wrote the article over, taking his advice, and he bought it. So that was my... So I began kind of slowly writing freelance articles on travel around in Provence and in Aix, and wrote some things for Bon Appetit magazine. So that was great fun, and wrote something for an essay for the Wine Spectator, and then some things for the Times in London, a few more things for the Washington Post. And so slowly I was sort of writing freelance articles on travel and food and wine. But then after a few years of doing that, I felt like I was out of the loop, that I didn't really know what American readers wanted because I was living in France. And I saw a job posting for a creative writing teacher at New York University's Paris campus. And this was actually years later. And then by that time, Eva was in junior high, and my husband was very comfortable at his job. And I said, you know what? I think I'm going to go for this job. It would mean commuting. You know, I'd have to take the train to Paris once a week. And he said, no, I think that's a really good idea. So I got I went up to Paris for the interview and I got the job. And during the interview, the dean came from New York to interview.
Oh, nice.
And yeah, the interview, went well. And he looked at all my articles and he was very pleased with them. And he said, you do have a book in the works, don't you? And and at this point, I had started writing the first Verlaque and Bonnet mystery about Chateau Bremont, death at the Chateau Bremont. But it was about 3/4 finished and I put it in a drawer because I was just so terrified, you know, terrified of other people reading it, terrified of criticism. I was even kind of afraid to show it to my husband. So I didn't finish it. It was in a drawer. And when the dean asked me that, you do have a book in the works, I said, oh, yes, yes, yes. You know, yes, yes, I do. So, you know, on the train on the way home, I immediately, you know, pulled up my computer and started finishing it. And finished it in record time, and then got an agent, Catherine Fawcett at Curtis Brown, and she's a real Francophile. She's from New Orleans, so I really lucked out with her. And then she found us Penguin, and
amazing.
that was how the first book. I always thought that X would be a great setting for a mystery. There are a lot of mysteries set in Marseille, which is kind of the big bad city down the road from X. But I always thought X reminded me a little bit of Oxford and, you know, in the Inspector Morse series,
right.
This beautiful, quiet college town. And I thought it'd be a good setting for mysteries.
Yeah. It's a totally different kind of scandal because Marseille is like, you know, they're always talking about the underworld in Marseille,
yes.
You know?
Yeah. And X, it's more family secrets.
That's one of the things that I've really enjoyed is that I think it's easy in a mystery to kind of, I don't know. It's almost, I've seen this a lot because I do love mysteries and read them a lot. Mm. And that you'll have like kind of a cardboardy victim. Like the victim doesn't necessarily, it's like, oh, he was such a bastard, you know, and right. now we get to figure out who did it because there are so many candidates. But I think one of the things that I've loved about your series, and in particularly in the most recent, is like how much care goes into each of the characters, no matter who they are. And their backstory and their life is as much a part of the story, that they're not just some, you know, body on the carpet, so to speak.
Thank you. Yeah, it's definitely my favorite part. One of my favorite parts of writing fiction is the character, developing the character. And before I start, even when I have sort of just the vague inkling of an idea from my next story, I'll go to Monoprix, which is our department store here in France, and I'll buy a few just notebooks, you know, the cheap notebooks that kids use at school. And I'll start with my characters that way and just start writing down their names. I really like trying to find interesting names, but that names that are easy for Anglos to pronounce and to read. And then I just start filling in I start with their name and then just start filling in kind of everything I can think about their personality, you know, what they look like, their education, their work, you know, whether they're married, whether they have kids, where they grew up in France. Because where you grew up in France too, that really kind of sometimes can make you a distinctive character. You know, people from Brittany are very different than people from Provence, let's say. So I have fun with the characters, and I think people are so important.
Yeah, I think the other thing that's wonderful is the kind of ongoing relationship between the two main characters that, you know, you'll often have in a series of detective novels, you'll have a partner, you know, two investigators, and they have kind of a bantery thing. But it's different when it's sort of this romance that at the beginning is quite fraught a little bit in the beginning of the series. And I love also getting the perspective, particularly in the first book that unfolds from each side of them, talking about, well, he did this and she did this, you know, about the relationship and that's sort of going through the center of the investigation and that they each have abilities that are unique to bring to the process.
Yes. I wanted to start with, I was getting a little bit tired of the, especially with, we'll say police stories or policiers, as they call them here in France, where the investigator or the police officer is usually a single man who's divorced and he's, you know, has drinking problem or, he's depressed, you know, a Wallander type guy. And as much as I like Wallander, I thought, well, I don't want to make my guy like that, even though I made Verlaque kind of tough and hard to crack through at the beginning. But I knew in my mind, I wanted a married couple who are happy, who had a good relationship. And so I wanted to develop Marine and Antoine's relationship that way, where it, you know, by the fourth or fifth book, they're in a good space in their relationship, and somebody just I forget who it was, one of the reviewers described them as the thin man, you know, from the Thin Man series of the Myrna Loy, and who is it? Is it I forget who plays her husband in the series, but I thought that was a great compliment to me. It's you know, that they kind of, they go through the investigation, and she, as a law professor and as somebody who grew up in Aix, brings her side of the story, whereas Antoine Verlaque is kind of an outsider. He's Parisian, he's posh, you know, but he's the magistrate. So, you know, as you say, they can work together that way.
Yeah, absolutely. I love them described as, Aix is Nick and Nora.
I think
there is something about, you know, bringing different sides of it. And I do love the insider outsider, because I think as the reader, you get to, I always love an outsider character, because often, almost always when you're reading a book, you're an outsider as well, and getting to identify with him. I don't know if I'm as posh as Verlaque is, you know, I don't have a vintage Porsche, but, I think that there's something about how they also are enjoying life, which is so different. And I think there is something lovely. It's like, aside from the murder part, there's a little bit about a vacation element of getting to go on a trip reading it. And in the most recent installment out, you know, that you all want to dive into, there's also a house that is a center point that you get to explore. And there's something really wonderful about exploring a mysterious house that's so well described in the inside of the book.
Yeah, thanks. I think my food writing, you know, her background comes out in the books. And it's something that I really love. You know, I like cooking. We love entertaining here at home. And it's something that we learned, we started doing in California, and then we really learned the importance of entertaining when we moved to France. And also then the houses, yeah, they're all kinds of just beautiful old houses in the countryside around Aix called Bastide, which is where the nobility, the Aix nobility, would move to in the hot summer months. So you'd leave your downtown mansion and then go out to the countryside. One of these, I've been in some of these places, you know, I have friends who own some of these places. Usually they're handed down in the family. And so, I love just exploring these places. So I wanted to describe one of these places. The first book, Bremont, is the same. It's a much bigger house, but I thought it's time I go back into another old house. I was inspired to do a ghost story too, but we'll talk about that later, maybe.
Exactly. Well, I think, the contrast I love is that in the first book, the house is kind of still, well, it has a caretaker. It's, you know, there's a whole family living in the house versus this one was kind of it was bought by a famous author after it had gotten a bit run down, and it's sort of being brought back to life. And I love both sides of the story.
Okay, good.
So I wanted to circle back to something you said earlier and talk about how this unfolded over time. But that moment when you said you had a book that was 3/4 finished and you were just terrified. And so then it was finished and then it was out in the world. And now there are a number of them out in the world. And I wonder how your relationship to the fear of the book being out there, how did that evolve and how did that change during the process of getting it published and then beginning to write more books?
Well, the first one, it happened so quickly that it just seemed unbelievable. and you know, especially the whole editing process. And then unfortunately I had a very good editor at Penguin, and then she left, she moved from Penguin to another company halfway through. So it happened so fast. And like I say, it seemed unbelievable. And then when it was published, it seemed very unbelievable that people were reading something I had written. It just, even though I had written articles for, you know, for big newspapers, but the book was something else. And then I don't know about other writers, but I got obsessed with reading every single review. You know, spending all my time, you know, just reading, you know, obsessing over that. And then after I'd say the third or fourth book, I think I found myself not reading the reviews all the time, you know, unless my agent and editors, you know, would point them out to me. So I must say, it's still, even this is book 7, the one that's coming out in April, it does still seem unbelievable, especially when I get emails from people, you know, saying how much they enjoy certain things, or they ask me questions about characters or some of my inspiration and things like that. It's I must say I'm still a bit up in the clouds.
That's great. Well, I think, you see this, you know, oh my God, these people are reading it. And I wonder, you know, at first you were just writing the book for yourself. You weren't even
telling
your husband. And then how does that change once you realize there are these people out there who are asking questions and want to know about the characters and are invested? Was that inspiring or was that intimidating, or both?
No, inspiring. I would say inspiring, because then from the questions, you can kind of figure out what people are interested in and what parts of the book they enjoy. And for example, in each book, there's always one chapter that's Antoine Verlaque smokes cigars and he belongs to a cigar club. And I think that's a way into, I mean, X already, people always say it's a very closed town, you know, so it's a very old town, you know, steeped in history and tradition. And people always say it's very, very hard for you to meet people who are born in X. Then again, I think since our daughter we put her in a French school, we were lucky, we met locals. I think we're both outgoing enough, and my husband's French is so good. People are always really impressed, like, oh, you speak such good French. And so that enabled us to make friends. And I think because we weren't French, we didn't fall into these categories of, you know, oh, they're from there, or, you know, they're not, you know, nobility, or, you know, whatever. You know, they couldn't really fit us into a box. And then so I was talking about the cigar club. So X is closed that way. And then you've got all these other closed bits of X. I mean, you've got the university, which is kind of a, you know, and then you've got all the lawyers, because X is a law town. You've got the court system. And then I thought, well, I can put the cigar club in there, because then that's this other closed society within this already closed town. You know, it's a private cigar smoking club. But I put it in there because it's, I try to make it kind of like the humorous chapter with, you know, these people, they go after work, they put up their feet, and they just, they have some wine or, and they smoke cigars, and they joke around and they laugh and they tease each other. And so people, will write to me and say, I really like that. I really like those chapters. I really like those chapters. So things like that, where I get worried, you know, are people going to be, you know, anti-cigar or whatever, but people write, readers write and say, no, we really like those chapters. So, I think because when readers write to you, then I think it is inspiring. Because you get ideas from them.
Yeah, absolutely. It's validating, I think, to say, oh, you really do like that. Because I think, it's, again, the whole thought of the going away from the Wallander kind of style detective. I mean, you have, you know, a magistrate who sneaks extra brioche versus one who's just sitting in a diner and, you know, drinking bad coffee and, you know, not... not really engaging, but there is such a sense of, I think there are so many things that go into the food and the cigar club too. I mean, I'm interested too, like you mentioned it before, that Marine is local versus he is an outsider from Paris and comes in, and there's a lovely dynamic between him and one of the detectives, I think, who always feels intimidated and feels weird about eating with him and is like, oh, am I going to order the wrong thing? And I love how all of the cultural elements also become like a mirror for class or a lens to look through about the other aspects of culture.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, there are all sorts of things like that you have to deal with, and especially accents too. Here, you know, if you're from Marseille, you have a very specific kind of accent that's quite strong, you know, and or from the south, not so much X, but in the villages around X, you know, you have that strong Midi accent, and of course, Antoine Verlaque doesn't have that, and yet this character Bruno, the commissioner you were talking about, he does. Yeah. You know, he's a farm boy, and that's right. And then in the beginning too, he's intimidated by Antoine Verlaque, or not so much intimidated, but not wanting to make any mistakes. And just like Verlaque's relationship with Marine Bonnet, he and Bruno become good friends. You know, by the, you know, fourth or fifth book, not to the point where they're doing the bees, which is, you know, the kiss on either cheek, you know, but they're at the point where, you know, Bruno walks into Antoine's office, makes himself a coffee, you know, they shake hands, makes himself a coffee, and you know, but I think it's still formal enough that, you know, I want to keep that formality that, you know, the commissioner does work for the magistrate and they're not going to be you know, kissing each other on the cheek.
Exactly. I think in some ways, do you find, as someone who has moved to France rather than a local, that it allows you to notice detail that that you wouldn't notice otherwise? That being a writer from the outside, it makes a huge difference.
I think definitely. Yes, definitely. Especially all those little social cues that you have to, that I had to learn. And that for a lot of French people, it's just second nature. So, you know, the fact that you walk into a shop, you say hello to everyone in the shop. You know, if there's a lineup and you walk in to buy a baguette, you say, bonjour, monsieur, dame. You know, hello, gentlemen and ladies. And then when you leave, the same thing. And everyone in the line says, you know, hello, goodbye. So things like that, I think that I really loved when we moved here. So I try to talk about that and bring that up in the books.
I want to pause for a moment to speak about this week's sponsor, Audible. So if you are listening to ML Longworth's story about how she up and moved to France, you may be wanting to use your audible.com trial to get a book that will transport you. One of my very, very favorites is the book Tender at the Bone by Ruth Reichel, which is read by the author. I cannot think of a book that better communicates love of food and her relationship to France and how it transformed her life. So if you're looking for something that will carry you to France, just like ML Longworth was able to do with her move to Aix-en-Provence, then I recommend using your trial at secretlibrarypodcast.com/audible to pick up Tender at the Bone by Ruth Reichel, read by the author. Okay, let's get back to the show.
Yeah, I think that's one of the details that's really wonderful, is like all of the setting. And then, and it is, I mean, there is usually a cultural element to what's happening with the characters in the story as well.
Yeah, whether it's some kind of intrigue, business intrigue in X, or, you know, whatever the mayor might be up to, or yeah, just some kind of social setting in a restaurant, what's going on, food, it could be food related, or it could be sometimes newsworthy. I get the local, I like to pick up the local paper here called La Provence, which people kind of like to make fun of. But, you know, every time I pick it up, I'll find some little article up on the third page where I think, oh, I can use that, you know, like, for example, it'd be like, an ATM, a bank machine that was bombed, but the bomb here, you know, the bomb didn't really work, and it just kind of, broke open the back of the door of the bank machine, thing, you know, where nobody's hurt or anything. But I'll read these little things, and then I think, oh, I've got to use that in the next book.
Yeah, I love those local details. Do you think it's interesting too? Because as a fellow art history degree holder, how do you think that your art history background influenced it, rather than, say, coming from a specific creative writing only background?
Oh, yeah, that's a good question. I'd say, yeah, there has been, I think maybe it's just my observation, my love of just looking, and then describing what I'm seeing. You have to do some of that. You have to do that in art history. And usually you fall into art history, I think, because you love looking at what's around you, and especially old things, or beautiful things, or you're interested in history, or the aesthetics, an aesthetical aspect of history. So I don't know if the same is true for you, but I think we go into art history for those reasons. So I think as a novelist, that only helps, because you have to describe places, you have to describe settings.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I'm always fascinated when people come to writing, you know, from another avenue, because I think it's helpful to know. So many people think, oh, well, I didn't get a writing degree, so therefore this is never possible for me, or, you know, I would have to get a degree. And I think whatever people have studied, the nice thing about writing is that you can bring that into it.
Yes. Yes, definitely. Yeah. We all bring our backgrounds into it. So, and the writing, the best way to learn how to write is just write, just keep writing, write and write and write, and then edit and edit and edit.
How long did it take you to get to the point of being at the 3/4 mark of the first book?
Oh, a few years, I'd say.
Yeah.
Because I kept starting and putting it away and starting it and putting it away.
Yeah, because they seem to be flowing now. Like, you're amazing in terms of, it's so nice. I'm like, oh, I always have one to look forward to.
Yeah, now it's one a year, so.
Yeah. Yeah. And is that, how is that pace? Like, how does that work? Like, what does your year look like in terms of putting one out every year?
It means I do a lot of writing in the summer, over the summer months, because I teach at NYU. But so that's from September to early December. And then the semester starts up again in February, and then we finish in early May. So it means I'm doing a lot of writing over Christmas in January, and then a lot, May, June, July, and August. But that's okay. You know, it's doable, because, you know, when you teach at a university, you have to do research, you know, and my research, since I'm not an academic, I consider my books, you know, is what I have to be doing. So, you know, the academic
it's
years.
It's definitely publishing.
7 months. Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
They always want academics to publish. Yeah. You've got that covered.
Yeah. So yeah, with Penguin, the contract is a book a year. So it's so far it's been doable. I also write on the train when I go up to Paris.
That's so lovely.
Yeah, because it's 3 hour ride and the TGVs are remarkably smooth, very quiet. It's not like being on an airplane. So I get a lot of work done on the train. There's no internet. There's no, you know, kitchen. You know, nothing to interrupt you. So
that's fantastic. Because you basically started teaching at NYU in Paris. Right at the moment, you know, when you were about to get the book started. So those
that's
two
right.
things have happened together.
Yeah,
and
that's right.
How did the teaching influence your writing? Like just the experience of being with the students?
Oh, I learned so much from them. And I think just the fact that we do so much reading together because we read a lot of essays together. And then we do group editing. We do editing together. And so I'm constantly learning. I'm constantly learning about the editing process. So that helps my own work. And then they're such generous writers. You know, the things that I learned from them when their first essay is a memoir and I just feel so privileged because they're very honest and hard on themselves too. You know, they're not, I said, be careful with your memoir. You just can't be writing about yourself all the time. It has to be balanced. You know, the reader has to get something out of it. And so I do learn a lot from them that way. Just, you know, they're funny and smart and like I say, very honest. And these are freshmen. They're only 18. So I do think there's nothing specific I can say that I learned from my own writing, but it's this big, just this general thing of you know, writers being generous, you know, and not keeping anything back. And also having their own voice, which I think is really important. I said, you know, I don't want you to, with these early papers, I don't want you to sound like what you think a grad student should sound like or what you think an academic should sound like or what you think a historian should sound like. I want you to sound like you. Use your own voice.
I think that's really important.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause I think sometimes when people are writing for themselves, it sounds very different. And then they start thinking, I have to write with a capital W. And then it all kind of gets, I don't know, stilted or.
Yeah. Yeah. And the reader, right. And the reader picks up right away on that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So what do you find, I'm trying to think of exactly how to phrase this. Mm-hmm. What do you find that they need to learn if they have that voice? What do you think is often missing? Because I think of that response you had from that editor who said, you need to add the senses in, and that was the key. Do you find that there's often a key, like the editor who said you were almost there? What are you finding with students or those who are just getting started writing? What are they often missing?
I think sometimes you just editing, you know, they have to do multiple drafts. So that's something I said, it's not like high school where you can stay up all night, write an essay and then hand it in the morning, you know. So you're going to have to go through various drafts and polish your writing. It always has to be clear. You know, clarity is something we work on. It can't be confusing. Read it out loud to yourself to make sure that everything is very clear. I want them to bring up, they're sometimes shy to use outside sources, to use other people's ideas, to use other people's words, and to integrate that into their own narrative. So that's something that we work on as well, because they're really excited with the first essay that they finally get to write about themselves. You know, they don't have to write about, you know, color symbolism in Virginia Woolf's To the Lighthouse, or, you know, all those essays that you had to do in high school that are always about somebody else's writing. And so I said, now you're the writer, you're going to write. But you can't go off and just write only about yourself, because then it becomes like it's dull, because, you know, it's just somebody talking about themselves. So there has to be that balance where you're writing about yourself, but you're also teaching us about something, or you're trying to raise a point about something. You know, there has to be this big idea to your paper. So there are various things. I would say all of those things combined. You know, some students are stronger with some of those things that I just mentioned than others. But, you know, no matter who the student is, there's always something that we can work on. You know, and these are students that did really well in high school. So, you know, they're sort of A students already. So by the time they get to NYU, but still there's enough that to work on for two semesters. So
as you are releasing a book into the world, do you already have another one in the works, given that you have this turnaround? How does that work for you? Because you're promoting one, but writing another.
That's right. It's a little hard. So in fact, the Bastide Blanche, which is the new one, I had to get I have a copy, you know, that's for the critics. It's the one that hasn't been edited yet, but I just had to pull that one off the shelf and kind of in my library and kind of look at it a little bit before this interview, because I'm so into the next book that I've got the characters' names, you know, for the next book in my head. And that story in my head. And I was like, oh, yeah, you know, who was that? What was the maid's name in the Bastide Blanche? Oh, yeah. So, you know, not that I could ever forget somebody like Sandrine, but, you know, you do, it is quite odd that, you know, you finish editing one book, then the marketing team takes over and starting to be promoted while you're starting the next book.
Exactly. Well, when you're on a book a year, that's sort of a necessary process. And I have heard that before, that people feel like, wait a minute, but I'm thinking about these other characters in this other situation. Yes. And now I have to kind of rewind my brain and potentially not reveal anything, particularly in a series like yours. They don't know about that yet.
Exactly.
But it's good to know that there's already another one in the works, and that everyone who's going to fall in love with the characters will be able to continue reading. There's nothing more wonderful, I hope this for many of you listening, that you are discovering the series for the first time, because then you have like seven books ahead of you, and you don't want to have to wait. You know, it's like when you fall in love with a series and it's like two books in, and then you're like, oh, I have to wait so long for the next one. Right. But when you have a big, long run of it, it's just delicious.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, we all have writers like that. At least I do. Favorite writers, where I go on a binge and I read every single book. You know, that they've written, you know, so, and then I'll reread them, certain favorite writers, you know, a few years later, I'll pull them off the shelves and then reread the whole series again.
Who are some of your favorites?
Barbara Pym is one of my favorite writers, an English writer who wrote a lot mostly in the 1950s, wrote stories that are quite funny, I think, and very observant of either English village life or usually a neighborhood in London, from the point of view always of a woman who's single, who's quite marginalized maybe, but who observes what's going on in her community, either in the village, often in the church, the Anglican church, or in her parish in London and her neighborhood in London. And like I say, they're very funny. She's been compared a lot to Jane Austen. And yet they're not romantic in the way Jane Austen's books are. Jane Austen's books is usually a wedding at the end, and in Barbara Pym's, there's usually a separation at the end. I mean, which is celebrated. The woman usually has a proposal, and she says, "No, thanks." So in that way, I think they're very modern, even though they were written in the 50s. And then in the early 60s, her publisher, Jonathan Cape, said, "We're not interested anymore. You're not fashionable enough for our readers," you know, because it was swinging London. And so she gave up. She tried a few more publishers and they all said, no, thank you. And she already had about six or seven books published at that point. And so she gave up, she stopped writing, and she was a civil servant. So she kept working at her government job, and then retired to Oxfordshire and lived in a little cottage with her sister, who was also retired. And then in 1977, the Times Literary Supplement asked various major English writers who they thought the most underrated writer of the century was, and Barbara Pym's name came up twice on two different lists, including on Kingsley Amis' list. Her books became overnight sensation. They were brought back into print, but sadly she had cancer by that time, and she died in 1980. Oh. But she was able to write two more books, and those were published before she died. So she's my favorite, one of my favorite writers. And Anita Bruckner also, who just died last year, the English writer, is, I think, a close second favorite.
Amazing. Now, I always love knowing who people are reading and what the influence is kind of playing in the back of their mind.
Right. Yeah. Those two writers too, when I'm stumped, you know, if I'm writing something and I'm stumped, I'll go for a walk, which is something I always tell my students to do. But I'll also, sometimes I'll go back and read one of their books. Because it's like this comfort spot, you know, this, that, you know, I always feel good. I always feel inspired after reading one of their books. Their characters, but also are very rich in, I think, in both of the Barbara Pym and Anita Bruckner. So they're ones I'll go back to.
Amazing. Yeah, I think that's wonderful advice. Like, just get out. Don't keep grinding away when you feel stuck.
Oh, yeah.
Take a moment.
Yes. Yeah, that's the worst thing you can do is just look at the blank page or, you know, the computer screen, which is something I do too. We all get stuck doing that. But, you know, or you just have to write and write and write and know, you know, sometimes I'll just start writing dialogue. I'll be writing dialogue, you know, and I won't even being, I'll try not even to stop. You know, I'll just write as quickly as I can. Just sort of he said, she said, you know, not even being very careful with it. And then I'll go back and edit it, and either I'll erase it or there'll be something. So before I erase it all, no, this is garbage. There'll be one little bit that I like, or one little bit that will help me to move on to the next spot. So I was, another thing I tell my students, if you're writing and you know, you're not feeling inspired, but you're just writing to get something down on paper, it's never a waste. Even if you do erase it all, right? There's something there. There'll be something tiny in there that's going to help you.
Yeah, it's like doing scales a little bit.
Yeah, yes. Yeah.
Going through the process of writing,
right,
and then finding more.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us. And I know that everyone's going to enjoy the Bastide Blanche. And
great.
Have a great time with that, and also to feel some inspiration potentially to expatriate based on your story, as well as to explore other cultures and to look out and notice everything around you as you're writing, because that can really inform and add to your stories.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Hey, everybody. As you know, or as some of you know, I am running a retreat this October with Kate Newberg and Tasha Harrison, who've both been on the show. And we wanted to have a little bit of a conversation so that you could learn more about the details. So here's that conversation, and we hope we'll see you in October in Portland.
We're talking today about the retreat we're planning in Portland in October. It can be anywhere from 20 people to 35 people. As long as you're writing fiction or creative nonfiction and you're a lady, we definitely welcome you. And Caroline, you have been to our special magical location before.
I have. It was actually, I have to give all the credit to the idea to the special magical location, which is, I heard about the Kennedy School years ago, and I actually went to a craft fair there. And I was kind of entranced. It was in the, quote, gym. It was sort of like a precursor to, you know, all these craft fairs that you see nowadays, like the bigger ones, like Renegade.
Mm-hmm.
And so I went with my friend and I was like, ooh, this is cool. It's like an elementary school, but it's not. And then I went back last summer for 4th of July weekend because I can't stand the heat and I leave Los Angeles whenever possible to somewhere colder. So I went to Portland and I stayed there and I was like, oh my God. And I did all this work on my novel in our little room that we stayed in that looked like a classroom, and it had a chalkboard on the wall and there was a desk where I could sit and work on my writing. And I was like, I think other people might dig this. I think this might be a good place for a retreat.
You think?
So after I was on Lady Books with the ladies here a little while ago, I happened to mention this idea to Kate and Tasha, who said,
Let's do this. I mean, because we've been thinking about doing something like this. Like, we were trying to do smaller stuff, like local stuff. We were planning things. Then you said, hey, I have this location. I'm like, bitch, this is it.
Yep.
This is the universe saying, let's do this.
Come to Portland.
And then I showed up with a spreadsheet.
Kate
dropped the bass with the spreadsheet.
Look, it was what, 4 days? It was like, oh, we might be thinking about doing this. Would you be interested? Yes. Okay. So let's get on email. These are my ideas. Katie was like, we need numbers. 24 hours later, these are the fucking numbers. I got the numbers.
They're so pretty, too.
She's queen of the spreadsheets.
Thank you.
But we'll come back to the spreadsheets later.
Yeah.
Because there is something to do with the spreadsheets. You may think, what does that have to do with writing? You will know.
Look.
We're offering just time to put time on your book. That sounds weird. Put time on your book. Spend time with your book.
To focus on writing, not necessarily the business of writing or all that frenetic energy around writing. Everybody talks about how horrible writing is, or how do you start writing, or how do you start when you're stuck, or all this other stuff. Like, there's all this talk around writing, but there's not a whole lot of writing going on at lots of events. Like, it's just like, oh, here's this thing you should do after you've written your book. This is the thing you should do to start your book. But there's not a ton of stuff out there for conferences or what do we call this, workshops or whatever, to actually get you writing and give you opportunity to write at the workshop.
Yeah, that was the thing that was important to us, is we wanted to look at what we saw out there and what we thought we could do differently that would suit us better if we wanted to attend. All of us kind of secretly want to simultaneously do the Hermione time turner and be in the workshop, but also participate in the workshop based on planning it.
Yeah.
Because as someone who goes to conferences and as an introvert, I go and then you're on the whole time and you don't really have time to get away, take a break, and digest what you've just learned and start to use it. So we really wanted to develop a schedule where you get to get fired up and inspired by what we're presenting, but also have time to work on your writing and take advantage of the fact that you're away from your everyday distractions and what you face and why everybody is always asking, how do I find time to write?
Perfect. Because, I mean, well, my main complaint about conferences, and I'm not going to name any specific conference, is just that, like you said, about being an introvert, and then every time we go, it's always like about the business of writing. And I don't, there's no point in focusing on the business if you haven't written the book yet. Like, you have to write the book first. And I find that a lot of, when you encounter a lot of writers there, some of them are just starting out and they're just getting deluged with so much information about like the business of writing, and nobody's really cultivating the writer. And I think that in what we're seeing now across the board for literature, especially with so many self-pub and indie pub writers out there, is that there's been a real departure from focusing on the craft of writing and developing a story and just writing a good fucking book, you know? So I'm super into that.
Something I would definitely like to see is, like, we've all talked about having that time to write, but also creating that community. So with a small group of, that could be anywhere from 20 people to 40 people, we definitely want to foster that sense of a small writing retreat. There's a reason it's a retreat and not a conference. You know, conferences can be very loud and very, like, you can find great information at a conference, but it's definitely another thing to have that small group, be able to focus on your book, maybe find like-minded writers that you can continue those relationships after the retreat. I think that that camaraderie part is very important to us as well.
Absolutely.
Definitely. I think that it's sort of like when you think about applying for a writer's residency, I always think that sounds so appealing. And it's like, oh, you could be out, you know, the whole fantasy about the torn sweater and the like cup of tea and the attractive view.
The cabin on the in the woods, exactly. Or like some secret place, like a little tiny town tucked away in a mountain community or some crap.
Yeah, and then maybe you're like pacing back and forth with some nice classical music or something. And then you sit down and you're just pouring pages and pages out. And I know people who have done these residencies and gotten completely blocked in those situations. And I think what we would hope that you would take out of the time you're going to spend with us is that you have tools that if you wanted to do that kind of thing, you would be able to work through it. And that the tools we want to give you that we're each going to present are the tools that help you break through any kind of resistance you might encounter towards sitting down and writing your book and getting it on paper. And that if you did go and do a retreat like that, you would have friends that you made at the retreat that you could stay in contact with. You wouldn't feel like you're doing your book by yourself, and that you have resources to fall back on should you need to.
Caroline, you just nailed it right there. No. It's like the resistance that we are, like, yeah. Pretty much everything that we're all presenting is about the resistance you feel when you think you've been blocked. Because I don't believe in writer's block. I think that it's either fear or inactivity that's keeping you from doing it. Like, that's basically what it is. Either you fear that you're not going to be able to complete it, or not be able to complete it the way that you think that it should be, or you just are lazy as fuck and you can't find a way to get into the story. I mean, that, like, really, like, there's two ways to get into it. It's like, you have to fucking do it, and you have to believe you can do it. I think that every workshop that we're going to present is probably going to attack at some level that place where all of us are kind of like, oh my God, this story sucks. I can't finish it. So let's talk about, like, what we're thinking about doing.
Yeah. How are we each going to attack resistance, or woo resistance, or cajole resistance, or
seduce resistance?
Yeah. All of
seduce it.
It.
Just make love to it.
Well, Tasha, that's a good segue for your...
but I'm not doing that. No. We're not going to be talking about sex scenes. I know that's kind of like my thing, but no, I'm not talking about sex scenes. I'm going to be talking about character development, because I believe that most issues with plot come from poorly developed characters. This is something that I encounter with a lot with the writers I work with and in my own work. Whenever I come to a point where I can't figure out where to go, it's because I don't know my characters well enough and I don't know how they would react to whatever particular plot point I've put in front of them. So yes, we're going to go through my whole bullet journal of character development madness. Welcome to my brain.
That sounds so good. I'm so excited.
And my workshop will be definitely more about a structural approach to plot. So there was the joke earlier that I'm the spreadsheet queen. I definitely look at plot as a way to kind of see how, like, your quote-unquote house is, if you think of your book as a house. Like, where
are... Here we go, you guys.
Where... Good with metaphors.
It's always with building and renovating. Katie's got a big ass house in her brain.
I do. But if you think about it, it's like, where do you walk into the house? You walk into that front first scene, right? So it does make sense. So definitely approaching your plot to see where it might be weak, but then you can strengthen it. So, and then using spreadsheets to attack it.
Because they're juicy and fun.
And they can be pretty and creative. I've seen these spreadsheets, and they are delicious spreadsheets.
Katie is like, she's the beautiful mind of spreadsheets.
It's incredible.
And what about you, Caroline?
Well, I think the other piece that I think ties together some of what each of you are doing, but I like to play with tools that get into the unconscious, both of the writer and the characters that you're writing about. And this would be true of both fiction and nonfiction. I've done these processes with both memoir writers, as well as novelists, as well as short story writers. And what I like to do is to utilize tarot in the process of developing both plot and character and the relationship, so you could take that further. I like to use it to address blocks, places where you feel like the scene isn't working. It's a tool that can really work well. And I like to use tarot as prompts. So I'm also going to be working with the whole arena of the use of prompt writing to support your project. So this is both writing you would do in your project, as well as writing you would do alongside your project to further develop it. So those tools will help you whenever you get stuck to keep going and to figure out why you're stuck, either because of characters that you figured out with Tasha. You can map them out and see things from a bird's eye view with what Kate's doing. And then we can work on kind of getting into the underpinnings, the collective of the story, and all of that juicy stuff that I really love.
Look at how we just mend in together. Like, I mean, what else?
When the universe is in flow.
Yeah. I mean, like, if you don't want to set up now, then you just basically don't want to be a good writer, and you can just go off somewhere and just do other things besides writing. You know, you could like be a waitress or, you know, dig a ditch or whatever.
Or if you listen to all this and think, I got that, then maybe we'll have you teach at another one when we do it in the future. If you've figured all these issues out, then just let us know.
I mean, come, let us know. Maybe we think that y'all don't know. Maybe we're just in the weeds. But I am super... I'm geeked to go to both of y'all's workshops.
Oh, yeah. You know? I'm going to be sitting there taking notes.
I mean, I know Katie's process, but I've never seen her, like, act it out. Like, I know, like, what her Beautiful Mind notebook looks like and all of her spreadsheets. Yeah. I understand that. And I know, like, basically, like, an overview of what you do, Caroline. But I am really super geeked to see what you guys do.
And then the great thing is, right after these workshops, you know, we'll have like a Q&A session, of course, but then it's like, you have like, I think we were talking about 3 or 4 hours to really apply what we were just talking about. So it's not just like, oh, you got great information and you'll forget it in your hotel room because you have to go next to a next panel. Like, you get to apply what you're learning or, you know, what you may have forgotten because maybe you used to do this stuff. You're applying it right then and there.
Yeah, exactly. It's a workshop a day. It's not like we're doing 4 or 5 things a day. It's a workshop a day. You have time to apply it. You can sit around and chitty chat with your writer friends that you've just met, or you can have one-on-one time with us to talk about your project. So,
and also the food. Let's talk about
food.
Kate, you should talk about the food because the food was important to us early on. The food is good.
For a number
good.
Of reasons. Yeah, the food is mm-hmm. also one, like... We had to do it because of the deposit. But 2, we want to make it definitely fun and nourishing for y'all so that you don't have to really go off quote-unquote campus if you think of it like it is a school.
Mm-hmm. It is, in fact, a campus.
Breakfast and dinner are included. We'll have outings. So we're going to go to Powell's, the bookshop in Portland. I'm sure there's other things we'll think of.
There'll
as
probably
we're
be some woo shops involved,
solidify. Too. Yeah, as we solidify the schedule, that stuff will... definitely come out. So it's not just writing for 4 or 5 hours. We're also feeding y'all. We're also going out and exploring books. We're also becoming friends. Oh, how sappy is that?
Also, there's a movie theater in the hotel.
I mean, there's lots of bars. Yeah. There's a soaking pool. I mean,
yep. Yep.
Bring your bathing suit for sure.
I mean, what is the weather like, though, in Portland
in October?
It's crisp and pleasant to soak in hot water.
Oh, it's a warm water. Okay.
It's a heated soaking pool, girl.
It's like a bathtub.
tub of water that you can soak in and stretch yourself and think about your writing. Yeah, all totally amazing. So how, Kate, can they find out more?
You can go to our website, secretwriteaway.com. That's secret, write as in writer, away.com. We have the early bird registration coming up. Actually, it might be out by the time this episode goes live. We'll see. But that is coming up soon.
Yes. So secretwriteaway.com. Either get your name on the list or snag your spot while the early bird pricing is available.
Yes.
Awesome. We'll see you in Portland.
Yes. Yay, Portland.
Thank you for listening to the Secret Library Podcast. The show is produced by me, Caroline Donahue, and Frederick Barry McWilliams Jr., my tireless audio engineer. To get show notes for this episode and all other episodes, please visit secretlibrarypodcast.com. To get updates, literary love, and notification when new episodes are posted, sign up there for Footnotes, my newsletter. And to learn about life coaching with me to work on building your writing life, visit carolinedonahue.com. If you enjoyed this episode, please share it with a friend. Gold stars to everybody who leaves a rating and review on iTunes. We're so grateful. Until next time, happy reading.